everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast. So without further delay, let's go ahead and get into today's episode. It's router bit of the month. That's right. Once again, thanks to the great folks over at Woodcraft and Whiteside Machine Company, we have another opportunity to try out one of these great profiles that Whiteside Machine Company has. And today, we're trying out a tongue and groove profile. And this is really, really great. Now, as you know, Woodcraft picks a router bit from Whiteside Machine Company's extensive collection of router bits. And they more or less put it as their router bit of the month. So you can easily pick this up by going online, maybe at mattsbasementworkshop.com and clicking on the link there. Or if you're lucky enough to have a neighborhood store, you can head over there. And for the entire month of September, they reduce the price to make it that much easier for you to get an opportunity to pick up one of these. So what exactly do we do with this one? Well, as I mentioned, this is a tongue and groove joint, and it's a pretty big size one. This is a half-inch shank, and the overall cutting diameter is about 1 3/8 inches. So it's a good size router bit, which means you don't use this freehand. This has to go into a router table. Now, it has two cutters, which work simultaneously to actually create the tongue portion of the tongue and groove. And each one of these cutters is about 9/32 of an inch. And that works out to just over 1/4 inch, in case you're not familiar with fractions. I have problems with them once in a while. But more or less, the cutter itself will actually cut a corresponding groove in a single pass. So you get a single pass for the tongue, readjust it more or less by just simply lowering it down on the router table, and you can then make the corresponding groove in a single pass. Really simple, really easy. And that works out great, especially when you've got a lot of work to do. Now, as always, Whiteside Machine Company puts these out as a carbide-tipped router bit. And the neat thing about it is, well, this is a big chunk of carbide. I mean, you can kind of see it on there. So that means not only are you going to have a long time between sharpenings, but once you do need to sharpen, well, because of how much is there, you're going to be able to get quite a few sharpenings out of this. So this bit is going to last you quite a while. Now, another thing, always got to talk about this, is this right here, their bearings. I love the bearings from Whiteside Machine Company because you can cake these babies up, you can, you know, just abuse them to heck, and the nice thing about it, they keep coming back. I mean, they spin like they're butter. It's just, it's amazing. So they're absolutely worth their weight in gold. Now, as I mentioned, it's a big hefty bit, and this is one that we're going to have to put in the router table, and we're going to head over there in just 1 second. But first, I want to do a little bit of a, we're going to review the actual tongue and groove joint and talk about why it's so great. Okay, so the tongue and groove joint essentially is a modified butt joint. It's just simply the fact that you have one side that has a tongue and another that has a groove. So one thing that you can do with it is that it actually increases the amount of gluing surface you have. But more importantly, that tongue kind of acts as its own, pretty much like a mechanical fastener, a support, if you will. So, basic butt joint. There you go, two pieces butted up against each other. And this can be very strong. I mean, obviously it's a long grain to long grain glue joint, so that's inherently strong on its own. But one problem with the typical butt joint is the fact that if you have a board that's wavy and you put it up against another one, well, all the clamping pressure is out here where my two hands are. But one problem is occasionally I know that you've run into this, you'll kind of get that waviness in the middle and you need to eliminate it. So you can come in with your belt sander, your hand plane, what have you, to take it out of there. So one thing you can do that's really nice about the tongue and groove joint, and I happen to have one that I cut earlier while doing some test pieces. So let's take a look at it. First we have the piece with the tongue itself. And this router bit actually cuts a 3/8 inch deep router bit, or a tongue, excuse me, and it's about 1/4 inch thick. And I want you to look at this. I mean, this is a nice uniform profile. You've got to play with it a little bit to get it set up and get it in place, but once you got it there, you just keep running all your tongues through until you have everything, and it works out great. And it's a very nice, clean shoulder also. It fits together really great. Now, the other part is the corresponding part is the groove itself. And this works simply by you take the pieces together, fit them like that, and now, if there was any play in this, in one or both pieces, they actually bring themselves, it's dead flush. There's no discernible waviness right here at all. So that's a huge plus, especially if you're trying to, say, maybe glue up a large tabletop or any type of surface whatsoever where you more or less want to bring everything together and you don't want to have to worry too much about going back in and making a lot of adjustments. So anyways, though, there you go. It's really simple and easy. Let's head over to the router table to see how we actually are going to make it.
Okay, now a couple things to note while actually cutting the tongue itself. Number one, watch the top cutter. Make sure you know where your fingers are. It's taking up to 3/8 of an inch off, so you're going to really watch it, especially with narrow stock. Now another thing is the use of feather boards, both to push the stock down and also against the fence, is really highly recommended. That way the stock for sure stays in place. I just didn't have them here for clarity.
Alright, so we made the tongue, we did it one single pass, and really when it came down to it, if you're working with a denser hardwood, you could easily make it in two passes and you're still going to get the same exact results. It's just a matter of simply kind of pushing the fence back until the edge actually touches the bearing itself, and then you'll just, you know, you'll get this beautiful tongue that's cut out from there. The shoulders are nice and sharp, and you just get a really, really good result. I can't emphasize enough how important it is to make sure that your fingers are out of the way of those cutters. I mentioned it just a second ago, and I'll keep re-mentioning it over and over. When you're cutting the tongue, obviously the top cutter is exposed, so you really, really want to watch where your fingers are. So let's head over, and we're actually going to use the tongue to set up the next part, which is for the groove. All right, well, now that I have the actual tongue itself, I want to create the corresponding groove. And the easiest way to do that is to leave the router bit mounted where it is. I've got everything unplugged, first of all, to make sure that nothing could accidentally start up. I'm going to put the actual piece that I cut with the tongue right on the table, hold it snug, face down, the way that I ran it through. And what I'm now going to do is I'm actually going to begin lowering the actual router bit itself until that top cutter lines up exactly with the tongue. It should pretty much, since they correspond with each other at pretty much the same exact size, the tongue and the actual cutter itself, I'm going to get it located exactly there, and now I'm ready to cut the corresponding groove. So that's what we're going to do next. I'm going to go ahead and get everything set up, and we'll come back and we'll cut the groove and we'll see how they fit together perfectly.
Now, to actually cut the groove, this is really, really simple, and as you see, you just simply, it's a matter of pushing it through. Again, using feather boards to push the stock down to the table and tight against the fence would definitely help to make it a lot easier, and you'll get a more uniform, consistent result in the end.
Okay, so we've got our groove, did it in a single pass with this particular species of wood, but if you have a denser hardwood, you know, you could easily do it in two passes, just like with the tongue. Once you've got it set up, it's just a matter of moving the fence back and forth, and you're going to get the same exact results. And it's a perfectly formed groove that's going to correspond with the tongue exactly the way you want it to, so you're going to get great results from it. Now, one thing I need to emphasize over and over is the safety issue. Even though the cutter is actually buried as we're making the actual groove itself, it's important to remember where your hands are as you're pushing the stock through. Because even though it's buried, once it gets to the back side, it's going to break through. And if your fingers are there, I don't need I say more? I mean, Halloween's coming up, but we don't need to see blood and gore for real. And speaking of Halloween, I mean, it is scary how easy this router bit really is. It should have been the router bit for October because it was that scary easy. But anyways, though, I have another idea of something we can do with the router bit. And since the tongue and groove is really, if you think about it, the way that it's set up, essentially we could use this to create, like, just a really basic square-edged, I should say, frame and panel door. So we could actually use this to route the groove that would accept the panel, and then we could actually do the end grains of the actual rails themselves to create a stub tenon. So that's what I'm going to do next. I actually have some stock made up, and we're going to cut a couple of stub tenons. We're going to come back, and I'm going to show you how you could actually use this to get, you know, just a really nice kind of shaker-style door.
Now, just like any time we're doing any type of end grain, you usually want some sort of backer board on the backside to help control any tear out. And one thing I like to do is I always like to kind of gang mine up together. That way you get it out of the way real quickly, and plus on top of it, there's a little bit more support, so you have a little bit more control. Now, one thing I failed to mention when I was showing you the run-up to this is I actually used a groove already in all four pieces that would be making this little bit of a frame and panel door, but you'll see it in just a second.
Okay, so now that we have all of our tongue and grooves cut, let's see what we can actually do with it. Now, like I said, the tongue and groove is essentially a modified butt joint. It's just that it makes it a lot stronger since the tongue actually acts as a mechanical fastener. And also, to some degree, it can actually, well, it increases a lot of gluing surface, and you can even decorate it up a little bit. So what I've done here is I actually have four pieces that, like I said, they're about an inch and three quarter, somewhere around an inch and a half, inch and three quarters wide. And normally if I was to do just a simple butt joint, I would definitely have to be clamping them up, put a little extra pressure in there, and then I hope that along this whole entire section, I could essentially get it nice and flat and even. Chances are I'm gonna have to come back and really kind of clean up the joint line so that they are in the same plane with each other. But thanks to the tongue and groove, as you can see, they come together, they stick together really well. I actually don't need as much clamping pressure to hold it in place. And a couple of ideas is you can either have just a nice flat panel like this, so it's all one plane, or you could even decorate it up a little bit. Now, one favorite one that I have is, let me see, I'm gonna do this first. Okay, you could simply take the edges and you can put a slight chamfer on them and you get a little bit of a result like this. Let's get the profile there if you can see it. And then when you're looking straight out like this way, it kind of breaks up the lines a little bit. This is a really great feature for, like, say, the back of a cabinet, something you're just trying to get something really a different look to. Another option is maybe you could, rather than just having one chamfer onto a flat edge, you could have essentially like a double chamfer, which would look a lot like, oh, wrong one, where is it? Oh, here it is. A lot like this. Again, notice the lines. You almost have a double line there. And you have to play with it a little bit, but you'll get a really decent result. Now, another option I have, and this is one of my favorites, I happen to actually have a molding plane that allows me to do a little bit of a bead so that I get something like this. Again, I have that chamfer, and then I have the bead, and I see the profile there. And let's see, let's actually just put that together with, with just a straight edge so that you see the chamfer, this way. Again, it's just something to play, you know, to play it up a little bit, give it a little bit of a different look. Like I said, tongue and groove is really great for the back of certain cabinets just because of the fact that you don't even have to glue it. It holds in place, and this way you have seasonal movement, you know, and you just put a nail at the top, nail at the bottom, and it's all set. Now, I had mentioned using the tongue and groove bit as a possible, just a basic frame and panel door bit. And here we have the actual ones themselves where we did the stub tenons at each end. So we're gonna fit that perfectly into the groove because obviously the stub tenon would be formed with the tongue profile. So we get that in there, we'll get this one in place. And unfortunately I didn't make an actual panel for this. And it's gonna look a little bit different than what it should be, but if you'll bear with me here real quick, I know I should have done this before I actually started filming, but there you go. It's just a really basic, hey, how's it going? You put the panel in here, maybe you can even do it for picture frames or something, but you now have a rather solid door because you have so much gluing surface that it works really great. So anyways, though, there are so many possibilities with this particular router bit, the tongue and groove. As I mentioned, it is the featured router bit of the month at Woodcraft for the entire month of September. They give a nice little discount on it. Of course, you can find the links at Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast, take you right to it. You can purchase it online, or like I said, if you're lucky enough to have a store near you, you too can actually, you know, go to the store and pick it up for the month of September and save yourself a little something and get a really, really great router bit. Now, I mentioned before, we have two swag winners this month, and it's actually gonna be, well, let me see, where did I put it? I'm gonna grab the names, I'll be right back. All right, well, I left the room and you didn't even notice. So anyways, though, I just want to go get the names real quick to find out who the actual winners were, make sure I got them right. I hate it when I accidentally, like, mention the wrong people or say the wrong names. So anyways, though, the winner for this month's router bit of the month, who's going to win this great tongue and groove bit from Whiteside Machine Company Woodcraft, is Linda Welsh. Congratulations, Linda. You're actually our first female listener who's won something. So, you know, thank you so much for entering in the first place, and congratulations. Now, we actually had a second prize, again, from Whiteside Machine Company and Woodcraft, and it's a set of these brass height gauges, and these are really neat. And these are going to go out to Bud Millis, so congratulations to you, Bud, for entering. Congratulations to both of you. Thank you for entering and for listening and watching Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast. Now, if you are interested in possibly winning some free swag, like next month we have another great router bit coming up from Woodcraft and Whiteside Machine Company, drop me a line at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com and get your name in for the swag. Just put swag, drawing, prizes, whatever you have. And then also, you know, that's where you can send me comments, questions, suggestions, and feedback. You can always stop over at mattsbasementworkshop.com and visit the site. And of course, there you can see the links. You can find other videos and other great shows. So anyways, though, I want to thank all of you for stopping by. And again, if you have any comments, questions, suggestions, hit me at the email and we'll be talking to you. So until the next time, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.